Welcome to Ngatsugitsi Qaumajuq. It's my honor to invite you inside Qaumajuq. My name is Stephen Boris. I'm a settler here on Turtle Island, born and raised in Winnipeg. And I'm the director and CEO of the Winnipeg Art Gallery, which was recently gifted with the Ojibwe name, Bindigin Imwasama. It means, come on in, the dawn of light is here.
Julia Lafford and Indigenous Kamperville Lungji Treaty 4 Territory, Wagushtorem. My name is Julia Lafreniere. My family is from the community of Kamperville, Manitoba, located on Treaty 4 Territory, and I am a proud member of the Métis Nation of Red River. I am head of Indigenous Initiatives at the Winnipeg Art Gallery.
We are located on Treaty 1, the ancestral lands and waters of Anishinaabe, Inanawak, Anishinaawak, on the unceded territory of the Dakota and the Dene peoples, and the homeland of the Métis Nation. We are committed to acknowledging our colonial history and moving forward in partnership with Inuit, First Nation, and Métis communities in a spirit of reconciliation and collaboration.
As a gallery, we have embarked on a journey to create space for Inuit, First Nations, and Métis people to tell their stories in their own voices.
Along with the WAG's collection of Inuit art, the government of Nunavut has entrusted with us their collection. This temporary loan involves the care and preservation of the artworks, mentorship, educational programming, and we are committed to helping with the development of a permanent home for their collection in Inuit Nunangat, the Inuit homelands in Canada.
Welcome to Iqaluit. My name is Madeline Alekirelek and I am originally from Resolute Bay in the High Arctic. It is my honor to be a part of this historic virtual grand opening. I acknowledge the elders, artists, and curators who have guided the creation of Qaumajuq. They continue to lead the development of its exhibitions and programming. Over the past year, we have all lived under the weight of uncertainty and darkness. We acknowledge the loss and grief in our communities, our country, and around the world as the coronavirus pandemic has swept across the globe. Our hearts go out to all who have lost loved ones. Art helps us heal. The darkness is lifting. We remember our ancestors as these art pieces emerge into the light. Qaumajuq is a beam of hope. Qaumajuq.
Indigenous language keepers, elders, and members of the WAG Indigenous Advisory Circle gathered virtually in August 2020 to name both the Winnipeg Art Gallery and the new Inuit Art Center, as well as spaces within. Indigenous languages Inuktitut, Inuvialuktun, Anishinaabe Mohin, Ihiawewin, Dakota, Dene Sulin, and Michif now have a permanent presence throughout these spaces. We are standing in Iluvut, the entrance hall, in Inuktitut. Iluvut means our relatives. This is home to thousands of Inuit artworks that also represent the artists who made them. These are our relatives, alive with spirit and story.
It is my great honor to invite you inside Qaumajuq, the first of its kind in the world. This is a new museum, a transcendent place where the Inuit vision and voices illuminate and inspire. As you take this virtual tour with us, we hope to share with you the power and beauty of these Inuit artworks in their new home. I never get tired of unlocking the world's largest Inuit vault. There's something kind of spectacular about that. We are now inside the world's largest visible vault dedicated to Inuit art. I'm here with Dr. Darlene Coward-White, curator of Inuit art, who has been with us at the WAG for 34 years, working in the field for four decades. Before we even get into what went into this, what does it feel like to be in the world's largest Inuit vault?
Oh, Stephen, it's so exciting. I spent maybe 10 months designing the 500 shelves that are in this three-story visible vault. And it was so much fun just being reacquainted with pieces that I hadn't seen in years, literally, the things that I had in my exhibitions and publications, and then to actually see them again and remember the artists that I often had talked to in the North. So now, here they are, they're on view for everyone to see.
So it's a three-story vault, goes up one story, it goes down one story, there's stairs, there's an elevator system that takes works up and down. I think you told me there's 500 shelves and roughly 5,000 carvings installed. It was a Herculean task to get it done, but it's not just installing objects on shelves, it's doing it in a very systematic, art-historical way.
Yeah, that's right. I felt that it was important to have it organized by community, the communities of origin for the carvings. And there's actually 34 different communities represented in this vault. And it's really interesting, I think, to see the differences in the styles, the stone types, the subject matter from one community to the other. Because this is all clay material, ceramics from Rankin Inlet. And you can see, you know, how different it is when you move over here
to Dorset.
Cape, it used to be called Cape Dorset. It's now Kingite. And you see a mainly green serpentinite stone in this area.
What I love about these spaces is it interacts with the visitor space. The only thing between us and the visitor is this wall of glass, but they're seeing objects, they're seeing you inside the space, whether you're a curator or a conservator. And I think the life of the vault, what we do here, is now on display, which is kind of exciting.
It's pretty cool. And I'm just gonna point out, this is one of my favorite shelves here. And it is an artist, Kiyogaka Shuna, from Kingite. And he is actually the father of the artist who did the big outdoor sculpture, Guda Ashuna. And so she learned to carve by watching her father. This section here is Pivirnutuk, which is one of the most creative communities in Nunavik in Arctic Quebec. And on this shelf, we have one of our best known pieces, actually. It dates to 1957, called Mythological Bird. And it's by David Ealuk, again, one of the most famous Inuit artists. And so I kind of indulged myself by putting just one piece on a shelf because it really is one of our iconic pieces in the collection.
It's totally worth it. I love, as you move through the space, that move miles, kilometers from one community to another, and to go from that artistic aesthetic to something like Baker Lake. And I think for the audience, the viewer, to look at not only the progression of Inuit art, but also stylistic changes from one community to the other, and then here we are in a whole nother region. You mentioned working for years in the basement vault, a windowless vault, and the pieces would come up every once in a while, artists would go down every once in a while. But in having some time in this space with curators and with some artists and with elders, they all talk about the light and the way how this light now is interacting with the objects, and the fact that most of these pieces are resilient in terms of stone, that we can show them long-term with light. But it does change that dynamic of how you look at the objects.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, the 5,000 pieces that are in this visible vault are all stone, basically, because we have the light. So we have our organic materials in another vault down underneath here.
Well, it is, without question, thinking about the number of objects in the space, on the shelves, from our collection, you have just curated the world's largest exhibition of Inuit carvings. And it's an amazing accomplishment, and it's done in a way, in a style and manner that is accessible, not just for researchers, for curators, but also for the audience, for the visitors, which is really exciting.
It's Yes, for sure. I can't wait for people to come from the north and actually look and look, try to find their relatives and their parents. And, you know, because, you know, I did mention that there's three generations of artists often in these different communities. So for the younger generation to actually come down, be able to easily see the work of their fathers and grandfathers is going to be really awesome.
Well, you built this collection, you've curated it, you've documented it, and now in an entirely new and innovative way, you're sharing it with every visitor to the WAG, to Qaumajuq. And Darlene, it's really extraordinary what you've done, and thank you so much.
Oh, thank you, Stephen.
Hi, I'm Juanita Taylor. I'm originally from Arvet, Nunavut. Now I'm living and working here in Yellowknife Northwest Territories as a journalist with CBC North. And I'm thrilled to see Qaumajuq becoming a reality. You know, it's remarkable to see and hear from generations that came before us, to learn how and why our Inuit ancestors were creating art. Now everybody will be able to connect to this rich history by exploring the beautiful artworks virtually from anywhere in the world. CBC North is proud to be a part of this extraordinary experience. In collaboration with the community, we are bringing video and audio recordings with Inuit artists out of the CBC archives and into the light. We searched our archives for footage from communities across the four regions of Inuit Nunangat. This was an Inuit-led project, and all the voices are Inuit storytellers and artists. These are beautiful, personal stories, and this digital platform also includes interactive maps and stories from emerging Inuit videographers who share their experience of contemporary Inuit life. It all goes live online in April, and we will keep adding to this rich, deeper exploration with more stories as we go. It is another pathway into the Qaumajuq experience. It is bright, it is lit.
I'm very proud to share with you a glimpse into a powerful day that allowed us to prepare Qaumajuq for this grand opening in a good way. In the summer of 2020, I passed tobacco to Grandfather Wamdi Wakita. He shared with me how to have this grand opening. He described protocols and a vision for how we could come together to honor the spirit of Qaumajuq and the art that lives here. That led to the creation of the Seven Nations Ceremony. In February, ceremonial leaders, knowledge keepers, and elders gathered here in different spaces throughout the building to ensure spirit could be everywhere within it. The ceremonial leaders represent the Seven Nations of Manitoba, Métis, Anishinaabe, Aninawak, Inuit, Anishininawak, Dakota, and Dene. We were gifted with the ceremonial leadership of Byron Beardy, Elder Dr. Mary Crochane, Elder Martha Pete, Elder Marcella Vezina, Victor Tsazazi, Grandfather Wamdi Wakita, Grandmother Pahan, Chief Dennis Meeches, and Jolene Mercer.
It is my honor to introduce the eclectic performance, collectively known as Aqtsik. Aqtsik chose the date and time of this performance very carefully. It coincides with the celebration and return of the sun. Some of our community spend weeks in the darkness, in the winter months, and when the sun rises once again, many of us Inuit participate in all kinds of celebration to welcome the sun. We celebrate hope and renewal and welcome the sun and a new cycle of life.
Ku gerin ulo riane, biuk sa katigina.
I'm here with Jamie Isaac, the WAG's curator of Indigenous and Contemporary Art, and of course the curator for Born in Power,
which features Black Indigenous women and non-NB identities that talk about image reclamation and image sovereignty.
So that was your latest show, and now we're in Inuwa in Qaumajuq, and it makes me think back 6 years ago when you came on board as a Canada Council residency in Indigenous curatorial work, moved on to become our first curator of Indigenous contemporary art, coming on board at a critical moment in the WAG's history when we were grappling with responding to the TRC's calls to action. And I think of how far we've come, but your role at that critical moment.
It was interesting because we initiated that residency for the intention of indigenizing, decolonizing, and to think about that with exhibitions, broadening audience, making space and inclusion for Indigenous artists in exhibitions and also the collections. So there were some lofty goals, but I think there were a lot of great things that happened out of that residency and now in the last 6 years.
And one of those, I think one of your first shows was We Are on Treaty Land, which was not a huge show, but for us a groundbreaking show in terms of what it said, what it did, and some of the partnerships that formed out of that exhibition.
That exhibition was important in terms of following Indigenous protocol in acknowledging that the Winnipeg Art Gallery is on Treaty One territory. And so that exhibition honored artists from Treaty One territory, but we also did a really great partnership with the Treaty Relations Commission of Manitoba, worked with their knowledge keepers and elders to activate the ideas of treaties and address deficient education in our education system and curriculum. And I think that was a great show in opening up the indigenizing of the WAG.
One of my favorite shows that you curated, one of the shows that changed my perspective, changed me, changed the WAG, and was incredibly popular was Border X, not just for the art or the spaces, but for the people and largely the Indigenous youth that came through our doors for the first time ever and left an imprint on this building.
That one, what was so important about that show at that time was that we created a safe space, an inclusive space for Indigenous youth to come in and actually see themselves in the space and see themselves being honored. And, you know, doing that through skateboarding and having a massive ramp in Eckhart Hall wasn't easy either. And I think it is representative of indigenizing and decolonizing these kinds of institutions with a systemic history of racism and exclusion. I think it really opened up more space for people to come to the gallery.
Mm-hmm. Planning that ramp, building that ramp, using that ramp was really symbolic of your curatorial leadership here. And I remember talking about things that we did, things that we want to do. And I remember you telling me, you know, we can't go back now. And with each step we've taken, I feel it is a step toward reconciliation. And then I think of some of the big steps we've taken. And I have to think about Insurgents Resurgence, which was the largest exhibition of contemporary Indigenous art in our history that you co-curated. A show that was not only physically huge, but it sent waves across the city and across the country. And for me, it was a moment in the WAG's history where a statement was made.
I think more than a statement was made. I mean, I think people felt that show resonated with them just because it took over 17,000 square feet of the WAG on all levels, and we partnered with so many different community organizations and artists that led that show outside the gallery walls, as well as taking so much space inside the walls. But I think also all of the shows leading up to Insurgents Resurgence had to happen, because we, in that time, have started and maintained relationships. We've worked with an elders council and built, I think, trust in the community to be able to celebrate a large exhibition like Insurgents Resurgence. And so I feel like that's a process, and I think it hasn't always been the easiest, and there has been some bumps and challenges along the way to address decolonial methodologies in these spaces. A huge part of that is making space and including more voices. And so with Julia as the head of Indigenous initiatives, and having Jocelyn as the assistant curator of Inuit art, these wonderful guest curators with Inua, it's just expanding. And if we can have more voices and perspectives in these institutions, it's only going to get better.
And so to be standing in this space, Inua in Qaumajuq, curated by four Inuit curators, which is historic, I have to think back and thank you for what you've done, where you've led us, how you've supported us, and laid that critical groundwork.
Miigwech. Well, I also want to say Miigwech and think about those that were here before me, my ancestors, and those activists that paved the way for Indigenous curators and artists to be in these spaces. And I think that's really important to honor that history too.
Thank you, Jamie.
Thank you.
One of the talented performers joining us to celebrate the grand opening of this cultural campus is Merica Sila. Youth across the North are making waves and receiving international attention through their art. Merica is an Inuk actor from Yellowknife. Her family is from Tuktuyaktuk Northwest Territories. She is best known for her role on the popular TV series, The Twilight Zone. Merica also specializes in stunts and special skills, including hoop dancing, fire spinning, sword, and staff handling. We will see Merica perform to music by Reet, who is originally from Pannuktuk here in Nunavut. Reet is a new artist in the electropop world, combining Inuktitut lyrics and deep vocals. Reed has been nominated for Indigenous Artist of the Year at the Western Canadian Music Awards. She also hosts a Inuktitut language children's show called Anana's Tent. I present Marika Sila with music by Reed.
Here we are in the learning steps. Now, the naming circle gave this room the name Iliptvik, and in Inuktitut that means a place we go to learn, which I think is so appropriate because learning has so many different meanings today. I'm here with Rachel Berg, the head of learning and programs at the WAG, who actually is the person behind the production of programs for every type of learning.
Yeah. I'm super excited about this space. You know, what I love the most about it is that it really is at the heart of the center. And that's learning is at the heart of this, is at the heart of Qaumajuq. So here we are in the learning center. We've got Viswaju, the collaborative research center there, the vault as well. And this is where we're gonna welcome kids when they come to see the collection, the exhibitions as well. I'm really excited about this too, because for me, it represents kind of the ultimate smart classroom in a gallery. So we're gonna be able to do amazing things in terms of distance learning programs. So we've, for a number of years already, we've been offering virtual programs, workshops, and tours to schools in the North. We've worked with Connected North, Cisco, a number of partners up in the North. It's been great to connect with these classrooms, but now what we're gonna be able to do is invite schools in Winnipeg and across Manitoba to come into this space. We'll roll down the screen and we're gonna be able to connect them with these classrooms in Arviat and Iqaluit and Cape Dorset. And they're gonna have amazing conversations based on, you know, the work in the collection. And particularly, this is really meaningful that we often look at our collection and specific pieces from different communities, and the kids from those communities then tell us about the artwork from their perspective, which is such a great, great way to learn, for us to learn from them. So it's a really
This gracious. Word, elliptic, is perfect.
It's perfect.
Because it's a place for everyone.
It really is.
And depending on how they define learning, Michael Malton, when he was designing the space, wanted to be both a learning space, a space that's on display, a space that's a stage. So if we walk up, I can imagine for a group of kids, we're coming in for a classroom, we can see other kids in there, you can see students in there. Comfy seats for anyone. But imagine if it's, I just think of a group of kids coming in for a school tour, they sit down and they have this spectacular view inside and outside, and there it is.
Isn't that amazing? Guta Ashuna's piece couldn't be more beautifully framed. You know, the gift, it's an incredible sculpture. I love that kids can look out to that. Mm-hmm. And that people from the street can also look.
They can see exactly what's going on.
Exactly.
And then let's jump to a film or a video performance. And it's not here yet, but coming very soon is this extraordinary theater curtain that will wrap around the entire space, black it out, and on the inside of the curtain is the reproduction of the Inuit artist, Olispia Shulatik's, her painting called Yesterday Today, which really documents her life in Pangerton on the Cumberland Sound. So kids, well anyone, they're in for a treat.
Absolutely.
Whether the theater is open or whether it's closed.
And it's almost like they're enveloped by scenes of the North.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
Beautiful.
I guess for me, the most exciting part about this space is that it is learning on display, learning exposed, the mission of Chaumajuq very much front and center. What about you? What makes this space special for you?
You know, I think I agree with you, and I think what I'm really most excited about is that we're going to be doing outside programming, inside programming. You're going to be able to see carving on the porch. You're going to be able to see projection shows outside, festivals. I love that idea of, you know, glass and transparency and being able to learn inside and out of this space. It's so exciting.
It is really what Chaumajuq is all about.
Yeah.
And I think for kids, I think for elders, for adults, for artists, coming into a space where their learning is illuminated by natural light, where they feel connected to the space inside, outside. I mean, it doesn't get better than that.
It doesn't. It's an awesome space.
Danse, Anin, Buju, I'm Rosanna Deerchild, host of a brand new podcast on CBC called This Place, coming in summer 2021. But right now, I'm in Winnipeg on Treaty 1 territory. The classroom in Qaumajuq exposes students in the South to the arts and elders and knowledge keepers right across the Arctic. There are many ways to make Inuit and other Indigenous art accessible to all, including taking it out on the street. When you approach Qaumajuq and look up at the exterior walls, what is striking is the size and shape of this large open space that rolls and bends, suggesting the northern landscape. This is another way to connect the north and south. Contemporary Inuit visual stories come to life in downtown Winnipeg for everyone to enjoy. There will be many more of these outdoor shows to expose Inuit and other Indigenous art in an accessible and free and engaging way to visitors, to students, to shoppers, and people just passing by. It is another pathway to the Qaumajuq experience. It is bright, it is lit.
Our next performers bridge two dance forms, traditional Métis jigging and hip-hop. Mikey, Jacob, and Sienna Harris are from Saguing First Nation in Manitoba. They are the Ivan Flett Memorial Dancers, named after their late grandfather, Ivan Flett. Their unique dance style has earned them 500,000 followers on TikTok. Please welcome Mikey, Jacob, and Sienna Harris, the Ivan Flett Memorial Dancers.
This is a great moment for the WAG, and it's an historic moment for Qaumajuq. I'm here with Dr. Heather Gluliorte. She's a university research chair in circumpolar indigenous art at Concordia University. She's also co-chair of the WAG's Indigenous Advisory Circle. But more importantly right now, I'm talking to the lead curator for Inuwa, which is the inaugural exhibition for Qaumajuq. So welcome, Heather, and thank you.
Thank you, Stephen. Yes, that's right. I'm one of the lead guest curators along with a team of incredible other Inuit and Inuvialuit co-curators, including Aseniuk, Kablusiak, and Krista Uliuk-Zawadzki. And it is such a thrill for us to get to welcome you into this space. We've been working on this exhibition remotely and here in person over many, many months now, and it's just so exciting to finally be in the space and to get to see all of the artwork in this gorgeous building.
So, and as we walk through, I know you're walking by new friends, old friends, pieces that you know, pieces that we had created, commissioned. But what I love about this space is the incredible diversity, range of imagery, of artworks, of media and stories.
It's very true. There are over 80 artists included in the exhibition, with over 100 works of art in this show, and that includes works from the collections as well as loans and commissions from not just within Canada but also Alaska and Greenland, so around a big part of the circumpolar world.
And I would say for myself, for many visitors to museums, oftentimes our understanding, our knowledge of Inuit art is what has been presented to us. And I think this is a moment when visitors can look at an exhibition like this and get a completely new understanding, a new narrative, a new authority on the art of the Inuit.
You know, when we as a curatorial team were thinking through what we wanted the exhibition to feature, we thought about wanting to be really respectful of the history of Inuit art and to all those who have come before us, the artists that we honor, but also to think about what's happening right now and where we're going and in the future. The future was a major theme of the exhibition. The title, Inua, means spirit or life force in many dialects across the Arctic. But when translated into English, it's also an acronym that means Inuit moving forward together. And that was the kind of the idea, one of the driving forces behind the exhibition was to think about where are we going in the future? What is the future of Inuit art? And I think that we can see from the exhibition that it's a lot of things. It is a real diversity, like you were saying, of media and kinds of productions. It's everything from sculptures and prints and drawings to drone photography and video art, new media works, wearable art, just everything really. Anything made by an Inuit could be Inuit art.
And I'd like to think that the architect, Michael Malton, may have helped you get there or helped us get to this point. And I remember taking Michael Malton and his family up to the north, to Nunavut, and going to several communities. And by the time he came back south, he had gone back to the drawing board to rethink the design of Qaumajuq. Yeah. And at the top of his list was what kind of space can we create for the presentation of art? Yeah. And what I love, their scale. So we're in a space of 8,000 square feet, 30-foot high ceilings, 22 skylights, not typical for the way we've been presenting Inuit art up to now. I'm hoping, but only you can say, if that's helped you in terms of getting across a new narrative.
Yeah, and I think, you know, just like you took Michael into the Arctic and he came back and changed his plans and turned this building into something that I think speaks to some of the landscape of the Arctic and to the land. Just in that same kind of a way, the Inuit curatorial team wanted to bring a little bit of how we view our own communities into the exhibition as well. So we didn't put up a lot of walls, as you can see. Instead, we worked with the informal architectures of the Arctic. So the ubiquitous shipping container, your grandmother's kitchen, even this hunting shack. This was created by Team Asuma. And this is actually a recreation of Zacharias Kunick's hunting shack, but inside it's a four-channel video installation.
The other thing you've talked about, Michael talked about, and as we see in this show, is the range of scale. And so you've selected some amazing small stone carvings from our collection. You've commissioned some. We have huge pieces. And I remember being with Michael in the north and him understanding that any object, regardless of the size scale, holds its own. Yeah. And I find this is the case with this show. They all speak.
It's true, you know, what's great about this space is that we have space in this room to give everything its own presence, I think. You can tell just looking at the scale of the space how exciting it is. And that's something that we hope, you know, that's something that I'm really excited for artists to get to experience, is to imagine the works that they can make in this new building that is just for Inuit and Inuvialuit.
So for some visitors, this will be the way they come into the show. It's a much more intimate space, and there's something about it that allows us to go deeper. There's an historical, there's a lineage kind of feeling going on here. I wonder if you could just tell us what it's like to come into this space for you.
So there's two installations in this room. This first one is really important to us because this is a installation that features four works from each of the four regions of the Canadian North. So the Inuvialuit region, Nunavut, Nunavik, and Nunatsiavut. And so we've included works made by our own ancestors. First that you see on the far right is actually made by my grandmother, Susanna Iglo-Liordi. Also in this space, we have this gorgeous installation. This work is called Four Seasons of the Tundra. And next to, in front of it is this gorgeous Amauti by Martha Kayak. And these pieces, we really wanted to ground the exhibition in these works because they remind people that the Arctic is actually a place with changing seasons like everywhere else. And even though our summers are a little bit shorter, they're still in the summertime. The Arctic is teeming with life, and so there's lots of flora and fauna and animals and, you know, the 24-hour daylight, all of those things. We wanted to bring that feeling into the exhibition.
I'm also impressed that the objects on display here represent decades of art making. And you have historical, modern, contemporary works. They all fit in, they all relate, speak to each other. And I think that is something that the audience will get, they'll understand in terms of that intergenerational quality of the show.
Absolutely, you know, there's also artists all the way from emerging artists to mid-career artists, senior artists, and elders included in the exhibition.
So I would love to leave Kilak, which is this space, which of course in Inuktitut means sky, and go upstairs to look at that mezzanine space, which also gives you this fabulous vantage point of this space.
Let's go upstairs. Now we're in Qaumajuq, the mezzanine gallery. Qaumajuq also means sky or heaven.
And when's the last time you've seen a sealskin spacesuit in a gallery, Heather?
I don't think I've ever seen a sealskin spacesuit in a gallery before or ever, but I know that the work was created by the artist who was thinking about when he was a little boy and out on the tundra wearing his you know, big parka and walking around. He used to think that he was like walking on the surface of the moon. The works in this part of the installation are really important because they represent the voices and portraits of LGBTQ people across Alaska. There's actually a lot of LGBTQ Inuit artists included in the exhibition. That was really important to us.
And we go from Alaska to Labrador to Rankin Inlet.
Greenland as well, right here.
Greenland, once again, transcending, moving across borders, geographies. What I love about the Rankin Inlet ceramics, which are from the Government of Nunavut and WAG collections, you know, it represents, just in those pieces, about 50 years of production. But it also does this generational connection again with objects and images and themes.
Absolutely. You know, we really love this kind of installation. I was talking earlier about how the exhibition is organized around architectures of the Arctic, but it's also got other Inuit design elements that I think that Inuit and Inuvialuit who visit the exhibition will enjoy. There is, for example, the way that we've displayed the ceramics here, and this is repeated throughout the exhibition, is kind of in the shape of a Y, and that references Inuit tattooing practices.
And once again upstairs, like downstairs, no square galleries, an openness, kind of a fluid quality to the floor plan, which I think gives you a fair bit of liberty in terms of how you present the objects.
Yeah, I think we had a lot of fun with thinking about how do we not do it the way that, you know, art galleries and museums usually display Inuit art? How do we really get creative with all kinds of different ways of exploring new installation formats?
And I love this view. So you have this space, and then you have this extraordinary perspective of Kilak, so sky, and you're even closer to the sky here. It's an incredible feeling in this space.
Yeah, you really do get the sense of the quality of light that I think is why we named these galleries Kilak and Qaumajuq to begin with. And then also you get to look out over the exhibition and see it from a totally different viewpoint, which is something that I think is really unique and will be a lot of fun for curators in the future.
And it looks as good up here as it does down there. I have to, I almost have to pinch myself. We're here, Heather. We did it. You have put together this extraordinary historic show in Awa, in Qaumajuq, and it just makes me incredibly excited and hopeful about what is next.
I hope that we contribute to changing the way that the world thinks about Inuit art, and I hope that Inuit and Inuvialuit and Inupiat and Yupik and all the Inuit, all of our Inuit family from all around the world, I hope they get to visit this place and make art here and see themselves here.
Thank you. Thank you, Heather.
Thank you, Stephen.
I can't do that one.
Inuduta, as Inuit, the land teaches us how to live in harmony with everything in our environment. Our very survival depends on this relationship. My fellow Inuk Inukhatigata Nailan Naritsugulu Sheila Wat Klutze is one of Canada's most passionate environmentalists who wrote The Right to be Cold. In it, she describes how Inuit place themselves within, not outside of nature. Sheila calls this inness. That is such a beautiful word, inness. It expresses our deep relationship with the land and sea, ice and animals. It is the intimacy of interconnected beings. It is that relationship with the landscape that lives in the design of Qaumajuq. Thank you all for joining us on this incredible journey. Na kung may ilagay yon yun na kaugama tunga sutsia lang abugu ilun na tatamaw nga kaumayong mot. Kano yun ang ilagot, huwe asugitsi ulo katsirit silo.
Julia, wow, we've come full circle. We're back at the entrance of Qaumajuq in the heart of downtown Winnipeg. And this outdoor plaza is called Nutak Tumaktiuk, which means big steps forward. Thank you for being part of this virtual grand opening with us. It is possible because of the generous support of our presenting sponsor, BMO Financial Group, and our supporting sponsor, Destination Nunavut, and all of the generous supporters listed at the end of our program.
We leave you for now with a performance by Don Amaro. He is a three-time Juno Award nominee and talented singer-songwriter from Winnipeg. Don is recognized for his advocacy work within Indigenous communities and beyond. My friends, Don Amaro.
I wish that I could relive some days, make all the right moves, all the right plays. But we're all stuck on this one-way track, this roller coaster don't ever let you go. slow down this ride. I wanna take my time. I wish the sunset would last all night long. There's nothing else I need than you here with me. This twilight hour plays a captivating song. Yeah, this twilight hour is right where I belong. I can't believe how fast time flies. And life seems to pass before our eyes. So little time, so much left to do. But it all feels worth it when I got you. Slow down this ride, I wanna take my time. I wish the sunset would last all night long. There's nothing else I need than you here with me. Yeah, this twilight hour plays a captivating song. Yeah, this twilight hour is right where I belong. Too many night skies have slipped away without saying the things I need to say. Oh, oh, slow down this ride, I wanna take my time. Wish the sunset would last all night long. Nothing else I need. And you here with me, yes. Twilight hour is a captivating song. Yeah, this twilight hour is right where I belong.